Hello everyone and welcome to Culloden Painting Studio. Today is April 16th, 2020 and it is the 274th anniversary of the Battle of Culloden. As the name of this channel suggests, it's a period of time that I'm particularly interested in, and I thought nothing better than to work on some Jacobites today. And look at painting tartan, which is often something that puts people off. It's a layered pattern, intersecting straight lines. So it's not a straightforward thing to paint. But hopefully in today's video, I'm going to present some shortcuts and show how it is possible to get some kilted warriors on the table without that much trouble. And the models that I'm working on today are 28mm Jacobite soldiers of the 1745 rebellion. These models come from Flags of War. They were launched in a Kickstarter a couple of years back, and they've just recently been followed up by the government troops as well. So both sides are now out. And though Flags of War are on a bit of a hiatus due to COVID-19 at the moment in terms of their miniatures, but they have recently relaunched their very good flags, so go and check them out. One of the things with tartan on the tabletop is that it really needs to be quite bright in order to sort of stand out from 3 foot away on the other side of the table. So trying to replicate the really intricate patterns that we see on modern day tartans is very difficult to do and actually can end up looking quite muddled. Another thing as well is that at the time there wasn't really a system of clan tartans as we're more familiar with now when it comes to hiring a kilt for a wedding, for example. So most Highland clansmen of the time, their tartans were something that was homespun or spun by someone in their community, and quite often bright colours were chosen. Everybody liked to show off a bit, so I'm going to stick to bright colours today. First of all, I've primed the model in a light grey. I've used some coat d'armes grey primer out of a pot, but you could spray GW grey sear or some primer out in the airbrush. Something like Vallejo's light grey would be good as well. The first thing I did was to take a bit of Army Painter dark tone and thin that 50-50 with the wash medium, lather that all over the areas of cloth, and then I've dry brushed it up with some Army Painter Spaceship exterior just to get back to that sort of light grey. This is some pre-shading, which is a technique often used if you're sort of working to display detail models. I think it's useful when doing tartan because you're going to be putting on some pretty thin lines when it comes to doing the pattern, and it is quite difficult to do even thinner lines to highlight. And by doing the shading first of all, you're not having to do really fiddly steps later. It does mean you need to keep your paints quite thin from now on in the steps, and certainly thinning them with water or medium is going to be necessary, so that you get some of the shadowing from the wash showing through. And the raised edges of the cloth are that little bit more highlighted. So I'll take these guys out and we'll get the first chap in with the first colour applied. I've chosen to go for sort of a red based cloth, so I've got some Vallejo Carmine Red. And if we look at the model, where I put that on quite thin, it's flown over the pre-shaded miniature underneath, and that means that we're already getting some highlighting and shading done for us without having to apply a wash now, or do any highlighting of the cloth with a lighter red. So it's a nice effect, and you know, not just for this model in particular, it's suitable for any kind of cloth really. It's a bit more time consuming perhaps in a prep stage, but you know, I think it saves time later on. First layer was done in Carmine Red, a couple of thin coats there. I chose something that's quite a big contrast to the red, which was some game colour Sick Green. And to begin with, I just worked on some horizontal lines. A good tip really is to start a couple of millimetres at least from the bottom of the kilt and try and space the horizontal lines equally. Obviously on a real piece of cloth you'd have many lines showing across the pattern of the plaid by the time you reach the waistline there, but from across the table that's just going to look muddled. So two or even one horizontal line on the kilt is probably enough. We do have more of the cloth coming up over the shoulders on the back. There is more to see, and I think it's more helpful from now on just to really look at the back of the model only. What you can see, just the cloth above the shoulder strap here, is that a little bit has gone a bit sideways, where it's in the groove of the cloth, it's started to flow a bit. Could go back and tidy that up, but actually where it's flown like that, that's the perfect place for the next step when I come to put some vertical lines in there. One thing that is helpful with the vertical lines is to try to keep some of them in the folds of the cloth, but equally some on the raised edges. If we are just putting them into the folds, then they can get lost and you don't notice them. And if you're putting them just on the raised edges, then you lose the effect of the highlighted red. So planning where to lay the vertical lines before you start is quite useful. And I always start them using a natural break in the cloth. For example, on this model, where we've got the scabbard for the sword, either side of that there is a vertical line with a few millimeter space, and it just gives the idea that there is sort of a regular spacing there, but you've got a starting point, which is the sword, so you can keep the spacing fairly regular. But a couple of vertical lines is all you really need. We're not crowding the space at all, and that way we are having a pattern that's visible from a distance. Now, on this cloth for real, where your colours, your lines intersect with each other, the way the thread is laid down, it means that you've got more thread in these areas of the green colour. So the green is more intense. So what I've done is I've taken a bit of deep green, and just where my lines intersect, have just layered a little splodge there, so it gives the impression that it's darker. There's more green thread there, and yeah, we could leave it at that, but you know, if you want to add another colour in, you can fill some of the negative space between the lines with something else that contrasts quite heavily. I went for some flat yellow. And I dropped from a size 0 brush to a 2-0 brush. And that way my next lines were just automatically going to be thinner with a single brush stroke. I mean, there is no shortcut in terms of learning how to do fine lines. It's practice. I can't really show you a cheaty way to have a steady hand. But lots of practice makes perfect. The pattern here, yeah, we're probably never going to find that on a bit of cloth for real. Those colours, they do contrast with each other a lot though, so it's quite easy to see the plaid pattern. And there's still some space in between the yellow and the green lines. We've got plenty of the red showing the original colour. So when you're viewing this from a distance, you're still going to get the impression of plaid and not just a mess of colours. Obviously, I haven't finished the rest of this model, but what I wouldn't do now is put any kind of wash over the top of the pattern. Any kind of brown wash or even a black wash, it's really going to muddy the pattern up, and especially in the recesses we just lose any sense of colour continuing. So doing it the plaid last, if you're intending to do a wash on the rest of the model, is possibly the way to go. Perhaps if you started with that light grey primer, do the rest of the model, then perhaps do your black wash over everything. That way you've shaded the leather, the shirt, the musket, and then you can start on the plaid. Or avoid washes at all in the finished product. So a couple of options as to how to proceed there. I hope this has been an enjoyable video. And if you've got any comments, please leave them below. Thanks for watching. Bye-bye.